And welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG Chick.
In Tekoa, we have a memorial for the Saints' War. They say a Rawatai artillery master contributed to the Godhammer bomb. I wondered if...
Of course. You want Rawatai to be a part of this history. Crow about how your people helped the Deer Ward. Maybe your Ranganui lied, Amawa.
On second thought, I'll ask Adair.
Adair. That's how you say his name, Adair. I love these little back and forths between our party members, you know? It's just awesome. Anyway, we're heading on to Ondra's Gift for the first time, checking out that district. This will be our fourth district in Defiance Bay. That place is full of zombies and stuff, so we've been to Copper Lane, then First Fires, then Brackenberry, and now Ondra's Gift. Coming in 12 minutes. Loving the game. Finding that out of all the districts, Copper Lane took the most time to explore and read and interact and everything. There's a lot in that district. Ooh, we're all smoky here. Let's see what this justice here has to say. Dunstan may not agree about the Forge Knights, but it's chain of command.
Sure.
Right. We're supposed to meet the lady who's going to help with that. What's her name? Vianna? I think it's Vianna. I'm hitting Q for quest. It should be J for journal. Vianna. She's going to be here in Ondra's Gift somewhere. Empty house on the northern end of the district. Well, we're going to explore this whole place. So... I think I see it. Looks like a pretty big place, all things considered. We've got an abandoned house. Kulfix house. Another abandoned house. Looks like she could be in that one too. Otta's house. The Salty Mast. Valian Trading Company. Ramshackle House. And a lighthouse. And that goes to Heritage Hill. Ooh, zombie time. So this place is pretty run down, huh? Anything in here worth stealing or trying to steal? An egg. Yeah. A refugee. If animancers caused a legacy, they have a lot to answer for. Who's asking the questions? We've had bad harvests before, but this year it was the worst it's ever been. I'm down to my last few coppers. What am I gonna do? You could always take to a life of crime. Whoever says crime doesn't pay wasn't doing it right. I'm just kidding, guys. Don't break the law. Be good. Can we look through a window? Is that what we're doing? The grimy windows have been papered over from the inside. I guess we're not looking over a window. We're just going to check out the complete outside of this before we go in anywhere. And we're going to read everyone's history, because that's how we roll. You see four flickering torches, the only sources of light reflecting across four tense faces. Harsh words crackle the air between them as they argue about their course, some wanting to return, some wanting to continue. They move step by careful step through the dank cave, noses pinched and eyes alert. One, a ghostly elven woman, is thrown into the air and onto the ground with a sudden snap, the victim of an unseen trap. The group is surrounded now, skeletal hands reaching from beyond the grave at the intrusion of life in their midst. The group scrambles for their weapons, but too late. The skeletons are already upon them. The fallen elf cracks her eyes open. One of her companions falls, about to be impaled by an ancient spear. Adrenaline floods her system and she screams into action, moving faster than anyone, just unconscious, has a right to. Eyes white with fear, she conjures a wall of fire, incinerating the skeleton and providing a momentary reprieve for the party. Breathing hard, they share a glance as the passage is flooded with flickering orange and ready their weapons. This time they are ready, and the skeletons last mere minutes before falling to the ground once more. I like that one. That was pretty cool. And Branwyn Gwyn. You see a young woman standing against the backdrop of a wide, grassy plain. Her face is all silver and shadow in the moonlight, and she looks down at the wooden raft at her feet. An older woman lies on the raft, her arms crossed over her chest, and her eyes... and her eyes closed in death. Her face is the same dark gray as the younger woman's, and her head bears the same curving protuberances. But that is where the resemblance ends. The younger woman takes a pendant from the older woman's neck and ties it around her own. The platinum medallion shows a crescent moon engulfed by a curling wave, the symbol of the goddess Ondra. The young woman pushes the raft from the grassy beach and into the tide. She stands in the surf and watches it disappear, a silver tear rolling down her cheek. A sad tale. With its crooked and missing shingles, the roof resembles a prize fighter's gap-toothed smile. That's an odd description. You know, these statues are just begging to be examined, and we don't ever have an option to do that. Hey, sailor, what you up to? Oh, he looks on... he's fallen on hard times, or maybe just fallen on the bottle. Hick! That would be the latter. Hello, courtesan? You look like you want to have a good time, honey, and I'm all open for business. I'll bet you are. You little vixen. Whoa! Querizimian. You see a body on a bench, a team of mages and healers buzzing around the room, shouting instructions and incantations. A pulsating crystalline device lies in the body's chest cavity, steaming slightly in the magically cooled room. The healer stitched the skin as a priest murmurs healing charms. Finally, it is done. The body is again whole. The mages gather for a final enchantment as the others watch, a complicated ritual that has them sweating rivulets. A hush falls over the room as the body shudders, electricity arcing from side to side, eyes fluttering open. For a moment he's there, but something is wrong. He goes to scream and... he's gone. The room is silent as they trail out, overcome, but... something stays, not quite tangible, and shouts wordlessly as it sees its own body for the first time. Ooh, not good. Not good. Okay, so this goes onward to Heritage Hill. Keep your guard up and your weapon ready while you're in the gift. Now, I guess Heritage Hill is the... no, Ondra's gift, right? Ondra's... duh. Duh, this gift. The one from Ondra. Really? So this place could be dangerous? That's interesting. I like this area with all these piers and planks and little bridges and such. I don't need a grappling hook. Thugs! What are you looking at? Get out of my face. Bragging. Shove off. You've nothing to talk about. But you... don't you want to be bragging? I got nothing to say to you. What are you looking at? Not much, that's for sure. That goes down. Sure, we'll go down. Oh, that's pretty... almost a maze of boardwalks and such. Let's check out what's over here before we go through more boardwalks. More refugees. Why isn't the Duke doing more to help us? I don't know. Maybe we should ask Tom Petty. I didn't want to come here, but my village wasn't safe anymore. Palagina.
God's damn that son of a cool.
Oh, I didn't even click on her. The angry woman clenches her jaw and stares out toward the harbor with glimmering golden eyes. Eventually sensing your presence, she turns her feathered head towards you. Feathered head, huh? She looks pretty cool, actually. Some kind of avian creature? Want to run a down-on-its-luck Valian trading company? If you have more than half a brain, you could really do something with it. She clenches her jaw and continues quietly. As long as you're willing to clean up a few bloodstains. What's going on exactly? Exactly? If I knew that, I'd be in a better mood. The only thing I know exactly is that Mr. Verzano is determined to wind up in a grave before the season turns. The woman looks back in the warehouse for a moment and grimaces. After a slight nod in your direction, she storms off. Okay. Shoo and bye-bye. Alright. I didn't get to ask her everything I wanted to say. Civilian Trading Company. Mr. Verzano gives the orders around here. What about Cartugo? What does he do?
Good day to you.
Well, you sell things. Come, take a look at my wares. Exotic goods shipped straight from the republics of Old Valia. Sure. Rot finger gloves? What the hell? Ooh. Grants spreading plague. These gloves were worn by a healer in Old Valia who lived in a village stricken by a terrible plague. Sorry. While most fled, he stayed behind, restoring the few he could not and easing the suffering of those... No. Restoring the few he could and easing the suffering of those he could not. In time, the disease spread to him, melting the flesh of his face and raising boils on his arms, but leaving his hands, eyes, and mental faculties untouched. His exposure to the illness had inoculated him against its most pernicious effects, leaving him disfigured but capable. Huh. Interesting. The Ring of Wonder. I want the Ring of Wonder. Grants second chance? What is that? Plus one constitution, plus one might, plus one resolve. The Druidic Order of the Ovates of the Golden Grove believe that the Ring of Wonder is the sapling of one of the great trees that surrounds Tir Evron in Twin Elms. One day, they say, it will grow into an even mightier tree, root-like fibers twined together, sprouting from a shining green bud. The ring adjusts to the finger of the wearer, but removing it can be a painful experience as the roots bond to flesh. What is second chance? You know, I think that you could be, like, resurrected or something like that, but it's only 710 copper. Hmm. Maybe if you strike somebody and miss, it gives you another chance to hit? I don't know. Belt of the Stelgar. Minus 33% knockdown duration, but plus 2 dexterity. Commissioned by a wealthy nobleman... In New Haomar, this leather belt has been dyed to resemble the felines for which it's named. Much taken by accounts of the fearsome beasts, The eccentric nobleman gathered pelts and hunting trophies, though he had never seen any of the creatures in person. When commissioning this belt, the nobleman insisted upon an enchantment which would grant him the Stelgare's grace and poise. Despite these mundane origins, the enchantment proved very effective. While the belt won't guarantee that the wearer will land on their feet after a fall, it will see them back in fighting stance more quickly. Amulet of Jokate. Jokate, I think. Sounds good. Plus two resolve. I like it. You're taking these amulets and stuff, rings, and just giving plus two resolves, but it's got all this backstory. It's awesome. Hope you guys don't mind me reading all this. I think it's rather fascinating. This amulet was taken from the ruins of Ir Glanfath by Imperial agents in 2664 AI, attempting to shatter the new and fragile peace between Gref Admeth Hadret and the Glanfathans. They found themselves in possession of numerous powerful and mysterious artifacts. Edirin wizards and animancers took a particular interest in this piece, particularly when an Imperial Watcher claimed to see the soul of the Forest of the Deerwood within it. However, when one of the wizards studying the amulet was driven mad, research ground to a halt. The artifact changed hands, and it was believed to have been stolen back by a Glanfathan rogue. The teardrop-shaped amulet hangs from a silver rope. It bears an image of a cardinal in flight on the front and runic engravings on the back. Wearing it produces a strange vibration that is felt rather than heard, as if something in the amulet resounds within the wearer's very soul. Cloak of the Tireless Defender. Only usable by fighters. Increased constant recovery. Modifies constant recovery. The most famous battle of the Saints War, other than the one that took place at Halgott Citadel, was the sack of Mercy Vale. While the main force of St. Widwin's army marched on the Deerwood from the north, two brigades approached from the east, reaching Cold Morn from a pass through the White March. The villagers of Cold Morn allowed the Red Saris to continue unopposed, an act of cowardice that still draws curses from Deerwoodens today. The soldiers headed north, planning to join the rest of the army at near New Yarma. The villagers of Mercy Vale had little warning and no time to prepare, but they fought to hold the Red Sarins back as long as they could. Though the town was burned to the ground after a few days of fighting, the delay allowed the villagers and tribes on the way to New Yarma to organize successful guerrilla campaigns. It's widely believed that the battle at Mercy Vale, as well as many skirmishes in the wilds, kept the Red Sarins from reaching Halgott Citadel before the Godhammer was in place. When survivors and family members eventually returned to see what was left of Mercy Vale, this cloak was one of the only items that escaped the flames. Completely undamaged, it draped the corpse of a warrior who'd fallen in the middle of town, the body so covered in wounds that identification was impossible. Yes, and they did not have dental records back then. Brishalguin Mind Marker. Only usable by... Oh, really? Cipher. Only 10% focus gain? That might be useful when I have a lot of focus, but it will only give me, like, two or three more focus. Or gain quicker. No, I gain pretty quickly. I think we're gonna skip it. Because if I wear this, it means I can't wear what I'm currently wearing. Which is pretty cool in itself. The Brishalguin, or Mine Hunters, were known throughout Ir Glanfath centuries before Edirin and Valian animancers introduced formal scholarship on ciphers to the continent. They were respected and feared for their abilities to perceive soul connections. When Edirin colonists first settled in Edirwood, they quickly aroused the ire of their Glanfathan neighbors by trespassing, sometimes accidentally and sometimes intentionally, on Ingwithan ruins. The Orlin of the Three-Tusked Stelgare tribe, a mute but preternaturally gifted cipher, used her abilities to monitor the border ruins and track the colonists who encroached upon them. To aid In her investigations, the Anamphath of Three Tusks Stalegar gave her this amulet, thought to be a relic of the Inguithans themselves. The public gift of such a revered artifact was a political move as well as a practical one, and it galvanized Glamfellen resistance to the settlers, particularly within Three Tusks Stalegar. It was lost, however, when the cipher was killed in a raid on a farming settlement. Wild Strike Belt grants Wild Strike Burn. Seeking to augment the power he wielded, even while in the skin of a bear, one ancient druid crafted this belt, which taps into the power of a druid's spirit shift to put added force behind each of the druid's strikes. The belt is enchanted to accommodate whatever form the wearer takes, allowing those in more feral shapes to enjoy the benefits of the belt's magic. Here's more of the normal stuff that we have here. Some pretty interesting scrolls. Vithrak Brain? What the hell is a Vithrak? The large gelatinous brain of a Vithrak. Though the Vithrak are known to possess impressive powers of the mind, there is no obvious source for said power on the brain's wrinkled surface. Why the hell would we buy such a thing? Aww. Beagle. The small hunting hound is an impressively loud baying cry. It makes a game travel companion trotting along at your heels. We have this... Who's it? Has it? I think Kanna has it. Or is it... Adair? Is that how you say it? Adair? I think so. Aw, Calico Cat! Kitty! This cat's furry coat is a patchwork of black, orange, and white, and it seems very content to shed it all over your belongings, of course. Awakened Adra. A vibrantly hued piece of Adra still humming with energy. What can we use these things for? Stalegar Tooth. Though not one of the large fangs for which Stalegars are famed, this sharp tooth is nonetheless impressive. So I guess it's one of their smaller tooth. Dank Spores. These small, feather-thin spores have delicate stinging barbs by which they cling to surfaces, passing creatures, and the inside of nostrils. Ugh. Ogre Blood. The potent blood of an ogre. It seems darker and thicker than the blood of smaller creatures, though similar in all other respects. I think we've seen that. A congealed mass of thick and opaque jelly. Ooze plasma. Tastes great. Last filling. Primal Flame. Right, don't we get these off of the blights? This bright little flame leaps and sparks with magical energy. Oh, so there's an earth sprite? A chiseled portion of rock, slate gray and pocked with gleaming minerals. When set on the ground, it floats a small distance above the earth.
Ooh.
I'd love to have one of those in real life. Primal Water. This water is pure and clear and seems to be perpetually in motion even when the vessel that carries it is at rest. Primal Wind. This swirling cloud of smoke and air flashes with occasional bursts of energy. There's Spirit Residue, we've seen that. Zorup Tongue, Awakened Wood, Beetle Shell, Drake Talon. Sickle shaped and impressively sharp, this talon was removed from the slain body of a drake. These are from animals we have not fought yet. Creatures we have not fought. Binding Copper. These tight coils of gleaming copper are typically found in conjunction with Adra, where they effect peculiar changes. What do they use them for? Electricity? Because they fill with energy, and you're going to put copper wire around it? Yeah, they're harnessing electricity, or someone is. Nothing today, sir, though he had a lot of fun looking through your wares. As you approach her, the valiant soldier returns an affable smile. Oh, that's nice. The ropes dangling from the crane sway in the ocean breeze. Oh, I've got a fisherman here. The tide's in. If you're wanting to get down to the shoreline, you'll have to wait until daylight. Will we? Would we really have to wait until daylight to explore more of this place? That's actually pretty awesome. Surrounded by scattered planks, it isn't clear whether this skiff has been half-built or abandoned or cannibalized for lumber. Poultry. Well, it looks like we can't explore that yet, all the docks and such. Hello? A refugee. Courtesan. You do not have much on. What's the rush? Come and stay with me for a while. That's quite alright, but thanks for no thanks.
What?
A sailor, that's what. Erp. Did we look at this guy before? No, we haven't been this side.
If it makes you rest easier.
Nothing about you makes me rest easy, Durrance. Kerned. A hooded figure leans against a wall. When he notices you draw near, he stands uptight and raises his hand to halt your approach. If you know the words, speak them, and we can do business. If not, then we are done speaking. What words? We have no business then. Be gone. Eh. The man regards you with wary eyes from beneath his hood. You return. Do you have the words? Why are we saying this? Did we find this out somewhere? Ignibion el Tfion? The thing is, we find out this stuff, these quests, I don't even remember them, I'm sorry guys. I apologize for the unpleasantries. I am Kerned, the Midnight Merchant, as some would say. I deal in sensitive commodities. Precautions must be taken. Now, let us do business. Huh. Oh, no, I just want to look at it. We got a bunch of gems and Ondra Tara. Translated as Ondra's Tooth, these are large Baroque teardrop-shaped pearls most commonly found and traded by Omawa. Lockpicks. Thank you. That's all we'll be needing. Don't have more, do you? Greetings, friend. You care to do business? Nope. Damn it. We need a reliable source of many lockpicks. I can't go that way. Another one? The prostitute holds her hips, thrusting her chest forward as you come near her. She's so coy. Same thing. Don't know if it's been half built or cannibalized for lumber. Where are we? Over here. Oh, okay, we're behind that. Jareth Lexingtail. More histories. You see only the barest glimpse of a jagged, disfiguring scar before it is hidden with a hood as the man prepares to leap. One window to another, scaling a trellis with soft, gloved hands, he moves promptly through the upper stories of a careless city. The afternoon is lethargic, empty, and he quickly hits three targets: a scroll hidden in some noblewoman's cabinet, a bottle of dark red wine from a blackened and dilapidated cellar, a pouch of coins from a feff-waisted, overly rouged young elf. He buys himself dinner at an overly orange, raw-scrubbed inn, and swills the wine as he eats, but his eyes are on the door. He has barely finished when it closes behind a white, sour white elf, his red eyes demanding answers. "What are these colors, man?" Unperturbed, he kisses her on the cheek, discreetly placing the scroll in her pocket before returning to his meal, a significant deal richer for the gold in his hand. That is a colorful tale. Hakami. Sashimi Nuki. You see an elven woman, her colorless complexion almost invisible amidst the falling snow. She is wrapped in white fur, tense eyes squinting in the glare. She moves rapidly, boots barely making the snow, marking the snow underfoot, snapping glances behind her. A howl rises, quickly joined by another and another, and she loses a prayer to the wind as she begins to run. The wolves gain ground quickly, loping effortlessly towards her. She fumbles with her spellbook, but it's trapped in loops of leather on her back. Not good. Cursing, she changes course towards a jutting outcrop of ice. She can hear them now, hot breath crackling in the frozen air. Breathing hard, she tries to run faster, nose crinkling against the sweat down her face, clammy. With a cry of relief, she reaches the ice and disappears. She falls into the small opening with a muffled thump, holding her breath as the wolves try to track her, confused in the snow above. She shivers uncontrollably from cold or fear, and tries to wait. I usually do read better than this, guys. I think it's just so much reading is just burning me out, literally. Oh, okay. Not literally. I'm not on fire. There's a lot of reading to do. So, during the day, I imagine all this would be gone. This water, and we can explore more. I don't see any reason to explore through these piers and boardwalks while they're partially covered, so what's down there? We can go in the water. We can go in that water. What? Grab his purse and go! Weren't we over there before? That's not good. They just robbed that guy. This man's fancy clothes are ripped, and blood flows from a fresh cut above his eye. He tries to push himself up, but his arm is shaking. He winces painfully. Help him up. Thank you, he gasps as he rises. My head. I can't believe they just attacked you in the middle of the street. Neither can I. He slowly stretches out one leg, grimacing at his scraped knee. It's a rough part of town, but the rabble's never been violent. Even a night with Achille isn't worth this. He limps away. Who the hell's Achille? Achille's heel? Are you Achille? Back in. I just want to get home. You look like you want to have a good time. Yeah. Where's this Achilles person? Okay, so this is the... This is the Durance. No, this is the Salty Mast, and we are going to go inside next episode. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.